Hey everybody, Star here, what is going on? And I have got a whole lot of man for you, because this is man up mode, man versus machine on the map, man works. And this is going to be from the very beginning of Wave 1 up until the very end of this match, so we have a lot of time to talk about all things related to man versus machine, which I appreciate, because there are a lot of things I really do want to talk about. But to kick it off, I'll let you guys know what is going on right now on screen, what I'm trying to accomplish on this team composition. This is a team of six. We are all working together on mics together. We know what we're doing. We're killing robots, and I am the scout who is dedicated to picking up money. That is my primary objective. I kind of fail on a few missions here, or a few of the waves, and I don't pick up all of the money, but picking up all of the money is important. That's why it actually is very nice to have someone solely focused on doing that. Because when you do collect all of the money, all the dollar bills land on the floor in one mission, you will get a 100 credit bonus at the end of it. And of course, you get all of the money that was actually picked up, assuming you don't miss any. Missing money is, you want to level up in this, you want to buy your upgrades, and having a scout out there in the field doing that for you is fantastic, because it is very easy for you to strafe bots. They don't typically aim at you right away either, because they'll focus down the sentries or what's really doing damage to them first. And just running circles around even the soldiers, they're never going to hit you with the rockets. And better yet is the fact that when Scout does pick up money, he overheals himself for ridiculous amounts. You can see right now I am at 400 health. It doesn't matter how much health you have, when you pick up money, you're going to be getting more of it. So staying out in the front lines as Scout is extremely viable in Man vs. Machine, because you are actually going to be very, very tanky. You've got Mad Milk, which I throw on them, which actually doesn't really help me out because I am way overhealed. It doesn't heal you if you're already overhealed, but helping some teammates out, you can upgrade that to slow down targets. But what I'm doing here as Scout in the first wave is immediately upgrading my run speed so I can just run around bots, pick up the money, and solely focus on that. Eventually in this gameplay, I will be upgrading damage and fire rate, but first off, I always do go for the movement speed when playing Scout like this. It just helps a lot to make sure you can be everywhere, be where you're needed, shoot somebody, walk away, pick up the money, and do your thing. Certainly, there will be more time to talk about this match as time goes on, because Man vs. Machine does usually end up lasting about 20 minutes depending on what mission you're in, but for right now, the one thing I really did want to talk about was the fact that Man Up mode costs money to enter. It is $1 to buy a ticket to enter Man Up mode, and this put a lot of people off because it's a free-to-play game mode, but they sort of hid in the fact that, well, if you want to play this, you need to pay money. And a lot of people are misinterpreting how this all works, because it is rather confusing exactly how this was all handled and done. And Man vs. Machine, Man Up mode, the only reason to come here and play this is so that you can win cosmetic modes at the end of it and keep track of all your statistics. Other than that, the free-to-play game modes are completely identical. Man Up mode does have advanced missions, which are more difficult, but you can actually go on a free server, play it without paying any money, buying any tickets, and have those exact same challenges. In fact, people are already finding out ways to edit the waves and edit the MVM profile so that you can have your own custom waves coming in, so there is more hope to have an endless style man vs. machine match. I believe a lot of the confusion on this comes with the fact that it's just so hard to find a proper MVM server right now, where if you do find one, just play whatever it's given you. Fine, I'm taking this. If you go down the server browser and join an MVM server, fine. Just play whatever it is, because you are lucky that you got in there with your friends. If you're trying to play with them, it's of course even more difficult. But if you are a server owner and you do have your own custom MVM server, hopefully you've come to find out already that you can load profiles on the map, where if you are playing on a free-to-play server, there are different advanced map profiles which are completely identical to the Man Up version. Once again, the only difference is that you will not be getting items for completing it at the end, and it will not be keeping track of your stats on your Tour of Duty miscellaneous item. In short, Man vs. Machine is entirely free to play with no exceptions, unless you want to get hats and track your stats, which I'm certain a lot of people really don't care about and they just want to enjoy this game mode with some friends. But if you do, it is 99 cents to get a ticket, and it is $1.99 to grab a voucher, which, to quickly mention us playing in the server right now, I believe this was our very first Man Up mode match. We are using 4 vouchers right now, which means at the end of this match, all 6 of us are going to be gaining 5 randomly dropped items with a chance to get the unique items that drop in Man vs. Machine. buying tickets to play in man-up mode is very comparable to just buying and opening crates. You have a chance to get some really cool items that you can only get from opening that specific crate, which are the machine hats for man-up, or you're just going to get some random miscellaneous useless items that you probably already have, unless you're new to the game, in which case this is probably actually a really cool and fun way to get some of the items which you haven't acquired yet. But unlike crates, there is something that I really would have liked to have seen done here, and that's the fact that when you complete man-up mode using your vouchers and you finally do get the items at the end of the round, you've spent money to get there, it'd be pretty cool if they could give you unusual quality hats of the machine hats, so you can get the robot Ushanka with a particle effect on it. I don't see why not. It just makes too much sense, doesn't it? Wouldn't it be nice if you went through all the way on Man Up, you finally completed it, and there was that sweet reward of an unusual robot hat? It seems like something that Valve would do, to the point where I'm surprised it isn't actually there, and I'm even thinking to myself, maybe it is in there, and just nobody has found one yet. Which, at the same time, I also find hard to believe with how many people have been playing this game mode since it's been released. And there are a couple few more very important things to note. For one, if you used a man-up ticket and you played a map and you completed it, you already beat that mission, you can play that mission again without using your man-up ticket. You don't have to use it a second time. And also, if you are on any MVM server whatsoever, any free-to-play one, you can call a vote to change the MVM profile to something equivalent of the man-up mode. There's going to be something like Decoy Advanced and Decoy Advanced 2. You vote to change it to that, and congratulations, you are playing one of the more difficult man-up variants of the maps. And like I think I already said, I'm pretty sure I did, people are already looking into their own ways to create their own unique profiles for existing man versus machine maps, which I am greatly looking forward to. Anything that increases the wavelength, creates more of them, makes it more difficult, is going to be right up my alley, because currently in MVM, it feels like right as soon as your character is getting all the upgrades you dreamed of, you play the final wave, and then it's over. Like, just as soon as you had everything you wanted, you get to play one round with it, and then you start from scratch all over again. I would like to keep going. I want to go until I lose. Endless mode is... that is what I want. I can't say it enough times. I keep rambling on about it, so I guess I'm done rambling on about it. Let's move on. Let's go back to talking a little bit about what is going on in this match right now. Team synergy is a very important thing in Man vs. Machine. You can see that right there, I enabled mini crits on the giant heavy robot, and he is taken down extremely quickly by the wrangled sentry and the heavy that's standing up there, dealing out most of the damage. It's very important to have, let's say, you know, a scout on your team to pick up money, at least one person who has access to something like Jurati so that you can deal mini crits at all times. It's very helpful to have a medic deploying crits whenever. The crits in this is extremely effective. It lasts for a very long time. It charges much quicker. And I think what we have here on this map was working out very, very well for us. At least one sentry to deal out the big damage. I'm helping clear out the bigger robots by enabling the mini crits on them with the Fan of War. We have the Demo Man clearing out the giant waves of robots. I'm picking up the money. We've got the heavy up here, heavy in this as well. It's pretty much brain dead how much damage you can do. You just stand there, I'm a heavy, you're dead. And these sentry busters are one of the big things that you really have to worry about when you have a sentry nest that you are really, really relying on. And enabling mini crits on it and having people focus it down, having people that you're actually playing with and working together with just to say, hey, there's a sentry buster, we all know what we're doing, make sure that doesn't get our sentry, focus it, and it seems to not be a problem for us right now. Our sentry right now is also in what I would probably say is the most effective forward position on this map. It is elevated on top of a weird box thing. And just to mention very quickly, it seems like when sentries are elevated like that, sentry busters have a very hard time destroying them. Even if they walk right next to it and blow up, occasionally it just won't do any damage to the sentry because the splash damage was blocked by the box that is elevating. That happens a lot in Team Fortress 2. And quick tip right here, if there are invulnerable bonked scouts coming in, don't detonate stickies on them. Look at them just raining down everywhere. It's like we got mortared with invulnerable scouts. We lose some money this round, we aren't able to get the A+ rating, and remember, another important thing is to blame your team. We all immediately blame the Demo Man. We said, you know what, if we missed any money, it's because one of those scouts went somewhere. We have no idea where they are. That's probably where the money is sitting. So remember, blame your teammates, it is never your fault. Next up, we have some tanks rolling into the area, which we all need to prepare and realize, hey, We need to put out a lot of damage on these things. Tanks take incredible amounts of damage. They roll up to your bomb point. They start to inject their bomb into your control point, and you will lose if the tank makes it there. You have a brief moment while it's trying to inject its bomb into your base, but otherwise, you really, really need to focus these things down. And one thing that's very important for trying to destroy tanks is that when you know a wave of tanks is coming, please, everyone on your team who deals damage, purchase some crit boost canteens. It is invaluable. And even medics. Medics, buy some crit boost canteens so that you can crit boost the person that you are healing to make sure they can deal as much damage as possible to these things. I only have one canteen right now, but realistically, you want to make sure you have as many as possible so that these things never become a problem. Because you'll say, oh, you know, it's really slow, we'll just take care of some of the bots and then focus on the tanks. But when they start sending two at you at a time and they start mixing them in with other waves and things like that, just make sure you can deal with them as soon as possible. Like I'm saying, because you don't want to fight them. They're pretty boring to fight. They take forever to finish off, and just finish off that fight as quickly as you can. There are a lot of builds and loadouts that just deal insane damage close up with the crits. Just go with it. Get it over with. Canteens are very important, and I haven't been using them as much as I should myself lately, where even the ammo canteen, which instantly reloads your weapon, is fantastic, especially if you know that you have a Kritzkrieg medic on your team and you have something like a direct hit or whatever it might be. The direct hit, if you can fire that off, you don't have reload speed upgraded, but you have fire rate upgraded and you have a clip size upgraded. Once you run out of shots, just use your reload canteen. And then just keep firing. It keeps up the damage and makes sure you get the full usage out of your Kritzkrieg. The other thing that will of course make you lose in Man vs. Machine is the bot which carries the small bomb. When you kill one, they drop it and somebody else will pick it up, and they are trying to carry it over to the end. That is the whole point of Man vs. Machine, is to stop the bomb. One thing that people don't realize is that the longer a bot carries the bomb, the more bonuses and buffs they get. There is a meter on the bottom of the screen which keeps track of that. That is actually what that's for. It shows you how long that bot has been carrying it, and once it hits one of the three stages, it gains a buff. Making sure you focus down that robot who is carrying the bomb is incredibly important, because that is the entire objective. Robots can make it around you and get behind you and do whatever stupid robot nonsense they are up to, but if they aren't carrying the bomb, it doesn't really matter what they're doing. A lot of times people will go and chase the scouts who make it behind you and say, oh no, I need to kill those scouts, they're behind us, they're making it past us. It doesn't matter at all. I mean, sure, they might come up behind you and start annoying you later on, but you need to put all of your focus on which bot is carrying the bomb and where is it. And one thing that actually makes pyro extremely effective in this game mode is that when a robot does in fact pick up the bomb, just air blast them back. Just don't kill them. Nobody do damage to them if the pyro is air blasting them back. You can push the bomb all the way back to the spawn point if you just don't damage them and keep air blasting as a pyro. If you're really not too worried about the bots picking up the bomb and walking forward because you have an excellent defense right now, you need to focus down the thing that you think has the highest threat and highest probability of taking down your defense. And usually, this is the Sentry Buster. That's why whenever one comes out, I run over to it, I hit it with the Fan of War, make sure it has the mini crit status on it, and we deal with that first, and then we go back to focusing down the bomb and making sure that all of the other insignificant robots are going to die. Whenever there are support robots on the field, you want to make sure those are kept in check. In particular, spies in this are really good. I don't know why, but the spy bots in this always seem to come up behind me and kill me. It's just, we forget that there's going to be spies, and once you forget that, you're in a bad situation, so make sure you stay conscious of that when you know they're coming in a wave, and always try and stay conscious of what you know is going to be coming up in a wave. If you've forgotten, press tab and it will show you which robots are going to be coming up. As far as my upgrades for Scout go right now, I have just been focusing primarily on my scattergun now that I am a full speed Scout. I have movement speed all the way up. I don't worry about blast resistance or anything like that because I think a full movement speed Scout is fully capable of dodging everything. The only thing that you really, really need to worry about as a scout is when the giant heavies start coming in later in the rounds. And even the smaller ones, they have a little bit better tracking than most of the bots do, but the giant heavies have perfect tracking. They will hit you every time. You can't really counter them as scout, and I don't think wasting money on bullet resistance is entirely worth it. there are much better ways around it, much better cost-effective ways at fighting heavies, and you really need to rely on your team for that one. So right now, I am just upgrading my scattergun in terms of damage and fire rate, so that when I run into a group of people that I want to deal damage to, I'm dealing as much damage as possible, and the fire rate is there so I can put the damage out as quickly as possible, get out of that fight, and then go back to picking up money once again. I'm not too concerned with reload speed on scatterguns, because there is a lot of downtime playing scout where you fire off your shots, and then you do need to pick up the money, you have some time to go grab some ammo, some health, you know, diddle around, twiddle your thumbs, whatever you gotta do, and then by the time your scattergun is reloaded, you can fire off one more huge blast once again, and then repeat the whole cycle. Bullet penetration on scattergun is another one that I like for late game a ton, because when there are the giant mobs of robots, you can fire one blast into them, not really have to worry about aim that much either, and it will take them down rather effectively. And on the Valve servers for Man vs. Machine, it can be quite laggy. I'm sure you've been experiencing a lot of it in this video, and there's really not much I can do about that, because Man vs. Machine pushes servers to their limits. It's 32 player servers running bot AI, and they're firing off a million bajillion rockets per second, as you can see that guy doing. Everybody on your team has crazy reload speeds and is doing something nonsensical, so there is a bit of lag to be expected, and with Valve servers, they usually are the bare minimum for what you need to begin with. This is a man up server. It has to be a Valve server, so there's no real way around that, and I haven't truly seen the effectiveness of having your own custom server that has the highest, like, possible awesomeness available to it. That is, in technical terms, highest possible awesomeness is something you can check when you own a server. I did just a little bit ago myself buy my own personal private MVM server, which I'm gonna see in the future how that goes. I haven't had a chance to plan it yet, but I'm looking forward to it. To go back and talk about upgrades again for a second, there is something that probably has clicked in your mind up to this point, where if you want to run around very quickly as a scout and pick up money, you might be thinking, well, isn't the Babyface's blaster the best choice for that? Because when you do damage, which will be very easy in this game mode, you will move up to ridiculous speeds. But unfortunately, the movement speed upgrades for Scout do not stack with the Babyface's blaster. It's really unfortunate because I want it to be the super fast high-speed scout moving as quickly as possible, but really that isn't actually an option. It doesn't stack, so what I have here is the scattergun. I've been using that the whole time, and really it's my personal favorite for Man vs. Machine, because it starts with the 6 clip size. It lets you stay in the battle for a long time, and when you upgrade clip size, it goes up rather quickly, where with the soda pop or things like that, it starts with 2 clip size, and nah, I'd just rather have it straight from the get-go, you know, crazy fast shoot speed. And for things like the Force of Nature, when it does have knockback against bots, which can at times be helpful, most of the time it was just making me miss all of my shots, and it was a little bit too laggy to follow up on the Force of Nature knockback. If this game mode does lag a lot for you, which I'm sure a lot of you guys are struggling to play it on older computers, you really need to look into getting an FPS config, lowering your settings as much as possible, putting your game in DirectX 8 mode, and all the things you can possibly do. One thing you're going to want to Google if you really want to make sure you can run this as smoothly as possible: Chris's FPS config. Look that up. There should be some information on that website as well and how to use it. It may be a little bit overwhelming at first and feel very complicated, but you know, give it a look over if you really think your computer would benefit from not having things at the absolute max graphics. Chris's FPS config can lower the settings even more than you actually can in the video option, so even on the lowest settings, if you're struggling, you should look into that. And right here in the gameplay, in a moment, we actually are going to have a really long time where just no bots were spawning, so I cut that out, I ran back to spawn, I got some additional upgrades to my canteen to where I have some crits now, and you're gonna see me die a few times from now on, where I get a little bit too greedy, and these are some of the harder bots for Scout to fight, as I was saying earlier. The giant heavy bots are very difficult to fight because their tracking is perfect. They will always shoot at you. I'm trying to take some shots at the medics to make sure that they die, or they at the very least pop Uber early so that my team can be the ones to kill them. But another thing that is really good about Scout is that here, I know this is the final wave, I'm not entirely concerned about picking up money anymore, because you don't need to worry about gaining the bonus from picking it up at all, because this is the last wave. There's no point in gaining a bonus. Once it's over, it is officially over now. So I am also being a little bit more crazy, trying to do as much as I possibly can, and dying a few times. One thing that is really good about Scout as well, not only do you get the health bonus from picking up money, but you get another interesting bonus, which is when you die, you have no respawn time. So here I am running in on a giant heavy, knowing pretty much I'm probably going to die doing this, but I really wanted an attempt at getting those medics to die before they had a chance to use their Uber, taking them out in one shot with the crits there. However, I really botched it up, and one tip I can definitely give you guys that is going to help everyone: H is a really weird key to press. It is right next to the taunt key for me. My taunt key is G, so it's even closer than most people, I think. I believe by default it's F, but my jump key is an F, and I have this whole horrible thing. But pressing H in the middle of a battle when you want to use your canteen is terrible. You want to go into your options and change H to something that is much easier for you to press. I have a button on my mouse, which I use now. During this match, I wasn't doing it, so I popped the crits a little bit early before I even got close to those medics, and it really messed me up quite a bit. In the options, it will be called Use Action Slot Item, and it should be H by default. But that actually does bring this match to a close. It's pretty much over right now. I'm just having some derpy fights with this last spy right here where I'm trying way too hard to kill him, but the round ends and everything is over. It's finished. We do get our prizes, which I took a screenshot of, but unfortunately my screenshot button is the exact same button as my replay button, so you have that in the way. But the point is that everybody got 5 items. There are 6 people, and only 2 of them were the new hats. And I was the only person who got hats. I was lucky enough to be the one who got 2 of them. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I will catch you guys next time for even more Team Fortress 2. Please like this video if you did enjoy it, and peace out, everybody.